In this chapter, we engage in an application of the general case to three phenotypic variations of CES production function. The three production functions we shall examine are the Leontief, the neoclassical as exemplified by Cobb-Dougals, and lastly, the AK production function. Through an analysis of each system of dynamic equilibrium, we will find support for the argument made earlier, and the history of the theory of economic growth can be seen through the lens of the history of production function. Different production functions exhibit dynamic behavior of different sorts that influence the contours of theories of growth. Differences in the predictions deriving from contending theories of growth most often boil down to different choices of aggregate production technology used to model the economy. After studying this module, you shall be able to learn about the neoclassical production function, understand the dynamic analysis of the Solow-Swan growth model, understand the intertemporal equity and the golden rule of capital accumulation, know the Leontief production function, the Herodomer model of exogenous growth, compare between neoclassical and the AK models. We shall begin our discussion on the neoclassical production function. The neoclassical growth model, which carries the implications of stable, steady growth in the long run, is neoclassical only so far as the production function it employs is neoclassical. The production function is considered neoclassical if it obeys four essential conditions. The function must exhibit constant turns to scale, positive but diminishing returns to factor at the margin, individually must satisfy the INADA conditions, and lastly, in order to avoid the redundancies, it must also be that the function should exhibit essentially. Let us examine these assumptions in turn. First is that of constant turns to scale. For the production function to be a function of labor, capital and technology, to exhibit constant turns to scale implies that when both variable factors, capital and labor, are multiplied by the same positive constant, then output is also multiplied by the same constant. Therefore, doubling the amounts of variable inputs used will double output, trebling inputs will treble the output, and so on for any choice of constant multiplier. In general, if both variable inputs are increased by a factor lambda greater than 0, then output would also scale up by the multiplier lambda. This property is also known as homogeneity of degree 1 in K and L. Notice that the production function is homogeneous of degree 0 in T. Multiplying T by a constant lambda would leave the output unchanged. Since T is assumed to be constant and exogenously determined, this assumption is defensible. Hence, function of lambda into L, lambda into K and lambda into T is equal to lambda into function of L, K and T. The assumption of constant returns to scale makes economic sense, is more meaningful if we employ the replication as rhetoric. This argument suggests that a production unit using K and L to produce one unit of output be considered as atomistic form of the production function, a molecular modular factory setup. If we wish to produce double the output, that is two units instead of one, we could simply install a second modular factory unit built according to the same knowledge blueprint or procedural used to build the first factory unit. For 10 units of output, we could simply replicate the first factory 10 times. For an n sized output, we would have only to build n factory units exactly like the first. Since technological know-how is non-rival, the blueprint can be shared and the replication argument and thereby constant turns to scale can be seen to be reasonable first assumptions. Second is positive but diminishing marginal returns to factor. With respect to each variable factor of production separately, the production function F must exhibit positive but diminishing returns to input at the margin. Formally, this implies that for all K greater than 0 and for all L greater than 0, DFT upon DK is greater than 0, DFT upon DL is greater than 0, d square f upon dk square is less than 0 and d square f upon dl square is also less than 0. Just as in microeconomic theory, positive but diminishing marginal returns imply that each additional unit of the labor factor employed in the production process contributes a declining but positive amount of output when used against a fixed stock of capital. The same is true of capital used with a fixed amount of labor, the Inada conditions. Inada-Ozawa conditions are due to Inada 1963 and his research supervisor Ozawa, and state that the marginal product of labor or capital approaches infinity as labor or capital use falls to zero and goes to zero when labor use or capital use approaches infinity. The conditions are stated as limit k tends to 0 df upon dk is equal to limit l tends to 0 df upon dl is equal to infinity, and limit k tends to infinity df upon dk is equal to limit l tends to infinity df upon dl is equal to 0. The essentiality is this assumption makes a claim that each variable factor used by the production function is essential to the production process in the sense that positive amounts of each are required in order for any positive output to be possible. That is to say, no input is redundant or completely replaceable in the production process defined by the production function. Mathematically, this implies the statement F0k is equal to FL0 is equal to 0. The assumption of essentiality can also be derived from the three preceding properties, as can another property of the neoclassical production function, as use of any input approaches infinity. Given that essentiality is satisfied, output also approaches infinity. Therefore, a fifth assumption could be included for the sake of the Reiger, which is F infinity and k is equal to F, L and infinity yield infinitely large output. However, since properties 4 and 5 follow as corollaries of the first three properties, most textbooks limit discussion to these three alone. Now that we have described the salient features of the neoclassical production function, let us now move towards the dynamic analysis of the Solow-Swan growth model, the fundamental equation and the golden rate. Let us first consider the equation which describes the capital dynamic. We know that the change in the level of capital over a period is given by kt dot is equal to it minus delta kt is equal to s into function of lt kt tt minus delta into kt. In order to transform this equation into the intensive form, which is more intuitively appealing, we divide both sides of the equation by the stock of labor L, yielding k dot upon L is equal to sfk minus delta k. We make one further substitution to arrive at an equation which is completely in per capita form. The derivative of per capita capital availability, that is small k, is equal to capital K upon capital L with respect to time, is given by kt dot is equal to dk upon L upon dt is equal to k dot upon L minus nk. Rearranging the terms give us the value of k dot upon L in per capita terms. Substituting this value into the relevant equation, we get the per capita or intensive form describing the capital stock dynamic. That is, k dot is equal to sfk minus n plus delta into k. The nonlinear equation is the intensive form fundamental differential equation of Solow-Swan neoclassical growth model. Since we have manipulated L stock out of picture, the fundamental equation in intensive form depends only on the k variable. The term n plus delta can be considered to be the effective rate of depreciation for k is equal to k upon L, the capital labor ratio or per capita capital intensity. Note that under the governing assumptions, this is a constant and exogenously determined rate. In order to visualize this fundamental dynamic equation, consider the figure given here. Of the three curves on the graph, the topmost represents the production function in intensive form. The straight line shooting upwards and out from the origin represents the locus of effective depreciation, that is n plus delta into k. The bottom curve represents the per capita savings out of income at the exogenously determined rate s. Now let us see how the major neoclassical properties are reflected in the shape of the curves drawn above. Firstly, both the per capita output curve and per capita saving curve start from the origin due to the property of essentiality, that is F00 is equal to F0 is equal to 0. Secondly, since the K factor must exhibit positive but diminishing marginal returns, both curves must have a positive but declining slope so that the curves rise as K increases but get flatter as they do. The Inada-Ozawa condition implies that both curves have a slope approaching infinity when K is equal to 0 and a slope approaching 0 as K goes to infinity, meaning that the curves are vertical at the point where K is equal to 0 and eventually become flat as K becomes very large. Now a cursory glance at the figure drawn will convince you that this is due to the particular assumptions of the neoclassical production function. The straight line effective depreciation curve and the per capita saving curve intersect only once right of the origin. Thus, the non-trivial solution of the dynamic differential equation of the Solow-Swan model is found at the point where the effective depreciation curve is crossed by the S into FK curve. This point is called the long-term or steady-state solution of the economy. Let us denote the unique K at this happens as K star. The steady state is a kind of balanced growth equilibrium. A balanced growth equilibrium is one where all the variables involved grow at the same rate. Thus, if one declares that with a growth rate of output of 10%, the economy has achieved balanced growth, that it must be that the capital stock, labor stock, and even technology, if not exogenously fixed, are growing at a rate of 10% over time. If this constant and common rate of growth were taken to be zero, then the balanced growth equilibrium is also called a steady state. The steady state condition for the intensive form of fundamental equation is thus the condition that K dot is equal to zero, or that the time derivative of the per capita capital intensity becomes zero. It is not difficult to find the closed form formula for this condition, which is S into FK star is equal to N plus delta into K star. In the steady state, all per capita quantities involved experience a zero rate of growth. Since K is constant at K star, the per capita consumption and per capita output also become constant at C star is equal to 1 minus S into K star, and Y star is equal to FK star respectively. Though the per capita variables do not change over time in the steady state, the non-intensive form variables, that is the Y, C, K and of course L variables, grow over time at the rate dictated by population, that is N. Now let us understand the intertemporal equity and the golden rule of capital accumulation. Let us motivate this section by asking the question, if we provide the same amount of consumption to the members of each current and future generations, that is if we do not provide less to future generations than we do to ourselves, then what is the maximum amount of per capita consumption? The conditional statement highlighted in the italics is the definition of what we call intertemporal equity. We have avoided using the term intergenerational equity in defense to the many Ramsey type optimization models in the early literature on growth models. The emphasis is, however, the same. If we are to be fair to the generations that will come after us, our ability to consume in per capita terms is to that extent limited. And we call this level of per capita consumption the golden rule for capital accumulation. In order to derive this rule for capital accumulation, let us first consider that for each unique steady state value, that is k star greater than 0, there is a corresponding steady state level of consumption given by c star is equal to 1 minus s into k star s, which can be rewritten by substituting the value of fraction of income saved, that is s into fk star is equal to n plus delta into k star, yielding c star s is equal to function of k star s minus n plus delta k star s. From this equation, simple calculus will reveal that the maximum value of consumption per capita c star when f dash k star minus n plus delta into dk star upon ds is equal to 0. And since k dash is positive, it must be that for this maximum level of consumption, the required capital K called K gold is Fk gold is equal to n plus delta. This is the golden rule of capital accumulation. The particular values of K, C and S can be called the golden rule values of the per capita variables involved. Of note here is that saving rate that exceed the S gold level are inefficient, since the same level of capital accumulation could be attained with a higher per capita consumption at all points in time. We say that the economy is over-saving. It could consume more at each point in the short-run transition as well as in the long-run steady state by lowering its saving rate. An economy that continually oversaves is said to be dynamically inefficient. A note on conditional and unconditional or absolute convergence. Convergence could mean one of two things in the context of Solow-Swan model. One is that since the derivative of k dot upon k with respect to k is negative, this implies that the further away an economy is from its steady state, the faster it converges to it. This is so since the negative derivative implies that smaller values of k are associated with larger values of k dot upon k. The mathematics is shown as dk dot upon k dk is equal to s into f dash k minus fk upon k, the whole divided by k is less than 0. This convergence of an economy to its steady state value could take two forms. One is called absolute or unconditional convergence, which applies when one compares economies with reasonably similar, if not exactly the same parametric values, that is S, N and delta. With such economies, it is expected that countries which start from a position of relatively poor endowment of capital labor ratio K will grow faster and eventually converge to the common steady state. Typically, such a country would also witness a higher rate of growth of output in per capita terms. The second and weaker hypothesis is called conditional convergence, which applies to cases where there are significant differences in the parametric values and therefore occupy different steady state positions. For such cases, we continue to make the claim that an economy converges to its own steady state value. It grows faster and further away it is from its steady state. This is true once the differences in parameters which determine the steady state have been controlled for. The second meaning of the term convergence is taken to imply that all economies in the world will eventually converge to the same level of per capita income. In other words, it is a hypothesis that the dispersion of per capita incomes across the world should fall over time. However, Barrow and Salai Martin show that this hypothesis does not follow from the neoclassical production function, even if absolute convergence in the first sense were true. Now let us discuss about the Leontief production function, the Harrod-Domer model of the exogenous growth. Leontief production function given in 1941 was the one which was employed in the expression of Harrod-Domer model of economic growth. First introduced to the literature by Harrod in 1939 and Domer 1946. The crucial distinguishing feature of Leontief production function is the assumption of no substitutability between factors of production. Hence, Leontief is also called the fixed proportion production function. The Leontief model observes the main properties of the Inada-Ozawa conditions, is linearly homogeneous and is homothetic. In microeconomic producer theory, the isoquants related to the case of fixed proportions production are L-shaped. In other words, the input requirement set for a Leontief production function is a rectangular set. A typical representation of the Leontief production function is y is a function of k and l is equal to minimum ak and bl. Fixed proportions imply that all the workers and capital will be fully employed only on the off chance that ak is equal to bl. If the availability of k and l is such that ak is greater than bl, then only the proportionate amount of capital, that is b upon a into l, is used, the rest lying unused. On the other hand, if AK is less than BL, then it would be the case that L minus A upon BK amount of the labor will go unutilized. The first step in the analysis of Harrod-Domer model is to construct an intensive form from the extensive form production function given in the equation for Y. We do this by dividing both sides of the equation by stock of labor L and obtain the equation for Leontief production function in per capita terms. That is, y is equal to minimum ak and b. The per capita or intensive form of Leontief production function is graphed here. The figure shows that for all values of capital labor ratio per person such that k is less than b upon a, the per capita output, that is y, increases in proportion to k, as y is equal to ak, which is a straight line to the left of the b upon a on the x-axis. At any value greater than equal to b upon a, ak exceeds the constant b, so that per capita output henceforth becomes steady at the level y is equal to b. This is the horizontal part of fk in the figure. We can exploit the general form of the dynamic equation in equation 3. In order to derive the dynamic equation for Harrod-Domer model, substituting for the specific Leontief production, y is equal to minimum AKB, we get the fundamental dynamic equation for the Harrodian model, which is K dot upon K is equal to S, minimum AKB upon K minus N plus delta. Now we can talk about the AK production function, an endogenous model of growth. The crucial and distinguishing feature of this class of production function is the lack of diminishing returns to factor in the intensive case, namely of capital. We should note that in what is called the exogenous growth theory, two genotypic variations of which we have seen above, it is precisely the property of diminishing returns to capital, which ensures that economic system exhibits a long-run steady state wherein per capita growth rates are all zero. By now, considering the possibility that capital may see constant returns to factor even in the long run or even increasing returns, as in some models of endogenous growth, which all incorporate human capital and learning ability as special forms of capital, we can construct and conceive of economic systems which exhibit endogenous growth, self-motivated economies that do not require an exogenous or out-of-the-model explanation of long-term causes of growth. The AK model is a special linear case of the Cobb-Douglas with constant returns to scale. The Cobb-Douglas itself is a special case of the so-called constant elasticity of substitution or CES production function. The assertion that diminishing returns does not set in the very least over the short to medium run is made for a variety of different reasons. Let us discuss some commonly used arguments and justifications defending why diminishing returns should not apply to capital in the short to medium term. One argument is that capital may not be subject to diminishing returns if we expand the definition of capital to include what is now called human capital, which is meant to capture the non-physical or non-manual skill set of workers. Some typical models have tried to incorporate learning by doing. These models are Knight 1944, Arrow 1962, Romer 1986, among many. These and other models have also attempted to incorporate the effects of knowledge spillovers or the externalities. It is commonly recognized that positive externalities in the production process can lead to non-diminishing returns to factor. It is also thought that capital may be subject to diminishing returns to a factor in any one production process, but may be less subject to diminishing returns once we aggregate over capital's myriad uses in all production processes throughout the economy. Finally, if we assume that depreciated capital is replaced using capital equipment and machinery of the latest vintage, then again it may be possible to avoid diminishing returns to factor under the particular production technology. The extensive form of AK production function is given as Y is equal to AKL. The intensive form of AK model, whence it derives its name, can be derived by dividing both sides of the equation by labor stock, that is L, as we have seen before, yielding a small y is equal to AK for the particular form discussed above. Both the average and marginal products of capital per person, that is K, are constant, and A, the positive parameter which characterizes the production function. The fundamental dynamic equation for this basic endogenous growth models can be derived in the manner as we have discussed earlier from equation 3. K dot is equal to S into Fk minus N plus delta into K. Substitute for the specific production function in the intensive form, Fk upon K is equal to K, we get fundamental dynamic equation for the AK model, which is equal to K dot upon K is equal to Sa minus N plus delta. From this equation, we can see how now long run growth in per capita capital labor ratio and per capita output can occur even in the absence of an external or exogenous impetus such as given rate of savings or a continual change in technology. The savings rate of the economy is now S, a constant, given fraction of the level of per capita output Y. Since diminishing returns to capital have been replaced by constant returns to factor, instead of a downward sloping saving curve, we now have a constant straight line saving curve as shown here. The effective depreciation rate is the constant term, that is N plus delta as before. Three cases are possible depending on the relationship between the savings curve and the curve depicting effective depreciation. If SA is equal to N plus delta, then the economy grows at a constant rate of zero in the steady state without technological progress. If SA is greater than N plus delta, all relevant per capita variables grow at a constant rate in the steady state given by the difference between effective savings and effective depreciation, that is SA minus N plus delta. The equation given here expresses this mathematically, that is K dot upon K star is equal to SA minus N plus delta. The dynamic equations for per capita income and consumption are also straightforward to describe. Since Y is equal to AK and Y dot upon Y is equal to K dot upon K over any period in time, therefore Y dot upon Y star is equal to SA minus N plus delta. Similarly, since consumption per person, that is C, is equal to 1 minus S into Y, the consumption dynamic also follow the K dynamic, Therefore, C dot upon C star is equal to K dot upon K star is equal to SA minus N plus delta. Let us now summarize by comparing the results of neoclassical and AK model. The difference in the assumption of diminishing or constant returns to factor leads to significant differences in implications of the exogenous and endogenous models of growth. Two major differences in outcomes are discussed here. Both are reflections of the suspension of the assumption of diminishing returns in AK model. First is effect of one time or once and for all parametric shock. Unlike in the neoclassical model of growth, in the AK model, a one-time parametric shock, say an improvement in the level of the technological coefficient A or an increase in the constant rate of savings S, leads to an unambiguous increase in the rate of per capita growth given in ED. It follows that similar changes in the given rates of depreciation or the rate of population growth also lead to permanent changes in the long run per capita growth. Second is absolute or conditional convergence. The AK model does not predict absolute convergence between the current per capita growth rate and the steady state growth rate of an economy. That is, the change in y dot upon y into dy is equal to v applies for all levels of per capita output y. There is also no indication for any convergence between the per capita income levels across countries or economies. Even between two countries of similar parametric characteristics, N, delta, A and S, it would be the case that a country starting out from a richer K, zero position, would be at a higher level at any time as compared to a country which started out poorer with a lower K, zero. This is so since in the steady state, both these economies would grow at a constant rate given by K dot upon K star is equal to S into A minus N plus delta. Between two track athletes who can run equally fast, the one who starts the race with a head start stays ahead. Analogously, in an AK universe, the economy that starts out ahead stays ahead. There is no expectation of any convergence in the absolute sense. These two points should exemplify the claim made at the start of this module. It really does seem to be that it is the form of the production function which most heavily dictates the dynamic process of the economic system. Therefore, the validity of any economic theory must first and foremost be examined with regard to whether the production technology or aggregate production function, it assumes a valid description of the actual production processes in a particular economy. Neoclassical production functions are assumed to be hold well and behave as appropriate descriptors of production when applies to the case of advanced industrial nations of the world. However, they may not be the most appropriate functions for the analysis of developing or agrarian economies or when market imperfections exist due to the presence of externalities or feedback dependencies. Modified versions of the production functions discussed here have been used with success in developing models of growth exhibiting multiple equilibria, low-level poverty traps, and other anomalous behavior. Such variations and modifications allow us to move beyond the simplistic and restrictive assumptions behind the neoclassical production functions and produce models of economic growth with greater relevance for the fortunes of the developing nations of the world, the ones for whom growth theory ought to be written. That's all with this module.